go over a very similar material as what Peter did in the last talk, but like I put there, it's reinforcement learning, introduction from an AI perspective. Perhaps for people who are finding it a little hard to follow some of the points that he was making in the previous talk, it could become clearer. And I will try to connect points of similarity between my talk and his, because he was kind enough to share the slides at 4 a.m. today. So, which was really surprising to me, which probably meant like close to midnight his time. But he did send the slides over, and so I've been working on mine to make it sync up. So let's see how it goes, right? And so I did borrow some slides from Rich and Andy from their teaching of reinforcement learning a couple of decades back, right? So just to refresh people's memory from the break, so reinforcement learning is kind of a trial and error learning paradigm where you learn through rewards and punishments. So you either learn about the system or learn about controlling a system, depending on whether it is behavioral or operant conditioning that you're talking about, right? And the whole goal here is that you learn about a system through interaction. And so I had to insert that. My students know that I never talk about reinforcement learning without asking, how did you learn to cycle? So because that's one of the immediately relatable example of how you learn through trial and error, right? So it's really, there's nobody teaching you how to cycle, and you have to get on a cycle and make mistakes, and you have to fall down, maybe get hurt, maybe not, but you have to at least fall down from the cycle before you actually learn how to stay balanced, right? So what reinforcement learning is essentially an encapsulation of this kind of trial and error learning mechanism, and coming up with algorithmic ways of doing it, right? And so we did hear a lot about temporal difference learning. It's a simple rule in some sense, but can explain a lot of complex behaviors, as was illustrated by Peter in the previous talk. The intuition is that you have the prediction of some outcome, an outcome of some events at time t plus 1 is better than the prediction that you can make at time t, right? Hence, use the later prediction, which is talking about like vt plus 1. This is a prediction of what the outcome is going to be, right? Use that in some sense to update your current prediction of what the future outcome would be. Right? So that's in crux what TD learning does. So we'll come back and look at the TD aspect again in the later part of the talk. Right? And so it's had profound impact in behavioral psychology and neuroscience, as was illustrated in the previous talk. But apart from that, it also has a lot of practical applications. okay, a lot of applications. Okay. Let's get to the practical part a little later, right? So that's a picture of a helicopter, and it's not a cut and paste here. That's actually a helicopter flying upside down. You train a reinforcement learning agent that can do trick maneuvers with the helicopters. It's something very hard for humans to learn, but people have managed to get that to happen. And here are a couple of games. That's backgammon, and at some point, the world's most powerful backgammon player was a reinforcement learning agent, right? And I suppose we can start making the claim for the game of Go now, or not. It beat one guy, at least, you know, all the other. Well, of course, the European champion apparently was a much weaker player than Leeds, right? So that doesn't count. So it has to beat Leeds it all again in another rematch, I suppose. Let's see. So, fine. So yeah, maybe we have the world's best Go player.
They had a lot of unofficial games.
Before they went on the match. Public games, yeah. Sure. So arguably one of the most powerful players in the world right now of the game Go is a reinforcement learning agent. And then you have other applications. So, for example, in robotics, reinforcement learning is a very, very popular learning paradigm, right? So here is an example from a RoboSoccer team from UT Austin, which used reinforcement learning not as an end-to-end learning paradigm, right? So there were a lot of pieces where they used more traditional supervised learning or even planning-based solutions, AI planning-based solutions. But there were certain critical parts which they found very difficult to come up with solutions otherwise, right? So they basically had to set up a reinforcement learning framework and then just get the agent to learn through trial and error. One of those was the stand and kick the ball. And the UT Austin team learned such a good policy, it could just score from the half line. Right? So just kick the ball fast, and it was getting so good at kicking it, it just kicked it into the goal. And they won so many games just because they could just kick it into the goal from there. Right? And so those kinds of interesting things, like this is why I said I kind of backed off on the practical thing. So many of these are, you know, still experiments in controlled conditions. I mean, you're not really throwing it out into the real world. But that is one example there where people did try deploying things for a while. So that is a content recommendation system. So at some point, Yahoo was running a reinforcement learning agent that was predicting news stories for people who visited their web page. And also in computational advertising, so reinforcement learning is a very significant component in picking out ads that you see when you enter search keywords on Google and Bing and so on and so forth. So yeah, it does have applications beyond in psychology and neuroscience. And so I'm going to kind of structure my talk inspired by what Supriyadayan did on so immediate reinforcement and delayed reinforcement. And in the immediate reinforcement part, I'll talk primarily about what are called mandate algorithms. Right? And I'll try to go a little faster because you have seen a lot of this already. So it's kind of just reinterpreting it for you from a different viewpoint. And the second half of the talk will be on delayed reinforcement, or what I like to call the full reinforcement learning problem, where there is this notion of sequentiality in the decision making, which is absent in the immediate reinforcement case. And then we'll go over a few of the structures that we need and talk about some solution approaches, right? So in immediate reinforcement, the payoff accrues immediately after an action is chosen, right? You don't have to wait to see what the payoff is going to be, as opposed to the maze task, which was discussed towards the end of the talk, right? So here, you make a selection and you immediately get a payoff, right? And so the key question in solving this kind of immediate reinforcement problems is this trade-off between exploration versus exploitation, right? So what do I mean by that? Right, so you have to explore to find profitable actions. You can't be behaving in a very myopic fashion and just do whatever you think is the current best action. So you really have to explore. And you saw the softmax rule that was used for exploration in the previous talk, right? So you need to have some way of trying things out, okay, even if you don't think that they are the best thing to do at that point of time. But also you have to act according to what you think is the best at some point of time. You can't continuously be exploring, right? So when do you start exploiting? When am I sure that I know enough about the system that I can start behaving according to my current state of knowledge, right? And so what are known as bandit problems in the literature kind of encapsulate this explore versus exploit trade-off. And formally, I would state it like this: an NR bandit problem is to learn to preferentially choose among n different choices, right? And each choice, right, is associated with a payoff, right? And that is drawn from some probability distribution associated with that choice, right? So again, this was introduced by Peter, but not in these terms, right? So I'm just stating it, restating the bandit problems after slot machines, which are known as one-arm bandits, right? So essentially, you put in your money and you pull the arm and it steals your money. So that's their one-arm bandit problems. And so multi-arm bandit is essentially you have a slot machine with multiple levers that you can pull, and then you choose which one you have to pull. That's why they call multi-arm bandit problems. So there are many objectives for the bandit problems, right? So the first one, which is the most straightforward one, that I don't care how long you take, but I really want you to identify the correct arm eventually, right? So you take as many trials as you want, but give me a guarantee that as t tends to infinity, you'll surely be playing the best arm, right? So historically, people have actually looked at that and have talked about rates of convergence to the optimal arm selection and so on and so forth, right? But more recently, so people have been looking at other notions of optimality. So one that is very popular is what's called regret optimality. So let's say that I have some kind of an optimal payoff. If I know how to behave, right? What is the optimal choice to make from the beginning of time, right? So I can expect some kind of a payoff to accrue, right? So that's the ideal case, right? So if I know everything about the system from t equal to zero, that's the way I would behave. But what's going to happen is it's going to take me some time to learn, right? So I'm going to make some different choices. I have to do my exploration, right? And then take some penalty. And finally, I'm going to approach the optimal payoff eventually, right? And the kind of loss that I suffer because I had to learn to approach the optimal payoff as opposed to knowing it a priori, right? So that loss is called regret. One way of thinking about it is, alas, if only I had known, right? That's the regret part of it, right? So the goal here is to minimize the regret. So essentially, how quickly can I approach close to the optimal payoff? So now I can't just say, okay, take forever. So however long you want, right? It's not a pure pure eventual correctness problem, but I have to worry about performance along the way, right? So the learning, the transient performance becomes important. There's another notion of optimality, which is more popular from a theoretical analysis point of view, because in some sense, at least in some cases, easier to show results along these lines, is what is called the probably approximately correct framework, or the PAC framework, right? Where I'm interested in identifying an epsilon optimal arm, okay, with a very high probability, right? So what I mean by epsilon optimal? If you remember, mu star is the best possible payoff I can get, right? So I want you to give me an arm that is no worse than epsilon away from mu star, right? When you finally say, okay, here is the best arm, keep playing it, right? So I don't want it to be more than epsilon away from the best possible arm. Okay, this is what epsilon optimality is. And I would want such an answer with a very high probability, right? It's possible that there are some really, really bad run of luck, you know, that you keep getting bad samples whenever you pull the arms, and then you end up converging to a bad solution. But the probability of you getting a bad solution should be really, really small. Okay, so that's essentially what the PAC optimality asks for. And the goal here is to give these PAC guarantees, right? Given an epsilon and delta, you should say, yeah, I've achieved your PAC optimality with so many samples. Right? So the smaller the number of samples you take, by sample here, we mean the number of times you pull the arms, right? So the smaller the number of samples you take, the better your algorithm is. So these are the some of the popular notions of optimality. There are a lot more, right? Where you have more resource constraints and other kinds of issues like non-stationarity in the reward distributions and so on and so forth. But these are simple enough notions that we'll start off with, right? So some of the traditional approaches basically try to maintain some kind of a running average of the rewards accrued whenever you play a different arm, right? So what this says is that, so whenever I pull arm I, right, so I keep adding up the rewards, I divide by the number of times I pulled arm I. That's essentially the kind of an empirical estimate of what the expected reward is for playing arm I, right? So I maintain this for all the arms, and at any point of time, I just tell you that the best arm is the one that has the highest empirical average, right? So the simple way to do that would be to have this kind of a stochastic averaging rule, right? And if I set my alphas to be 1 by ki plus 1, right? So alpha I is 1 by ki plus 1, where ki is the number of times I have played arm I, right? So this exactly reduces to that update rule, right? It exactly reduces to the average. And if my alpha, and I have other choices of alpha, in particular if my alpha is a constant, I then have the weighted update rule, which Peter Diane was talking about, right? So where more recent rewards get a higher weight and rewards in the past get a lower weight. You remember the curve that he showed with the weight? So essentially, if alpha is a constant, you get a similar update to that, right? And so this is a very, very simple approach. But what is missing here is that I need a way to do exploration, right? So depending on different exploration strategies, you get different algorithms. The most popular ones are called epsilon greedy, right? So where I select the current best arm, right, with probability 1 minus epsilon, and then I behave arbitrarily with probability epsilon, right? So that essentially means that I always have some non-zero probability of picking an arm, even if I think it's a really bad arm, right? I don't claim that's the best way to do exploration, but that's in some sense a very popular way to do exploration, and works in many cases. In fact, in many simulated environments, epsilon greedy is actually incredibly hard to beat. And the other one is, of course, the other popular method is softmax, which Peter already spoke about. And so this is essentially the probability of picking ARM AI in the time step k, right? And so that's some kind of thing proportional to your current estimate of what the value is, right? And for both of these approaches, and there is this whole host of different exploration strategies. I mean, there is this kind of a cottage industry in RL coming up with new exploration strategies. So that's all of these have some kind of asymptotic convergence guarantees, at least. Okay. Some many of the newer forms of exploration strategies have much stronger guarantees. And so here's an example of how epsilon greedy would operate. So this is time step, and this is like a 10-arm bandit problem, which the rewards randomly set up, right? And so the smaller the value of epsilon, you can see that for epsilon equal to zero, which means I always play the best arm, right? Whatever I think is the best arm. So I do converge quickly, but I converge to something suboptimal. Right? So for values of epsilon, that's non-zero, right? So my convergence behavior is going to vary. So when I'm exploring very, very slowly, this means that like 1% of my actions are taken at random, and 99% of the times I'm behaving as if the current estimate is the right one, right? So I still keep learning, so I've not stopped learning. And in fact, if this curve extends out to infinity, this will eventually overtake epsilon equal to 0.1. But you can see that the more I explore, more rapidly I actually discover better solutions. Okay, so there's a trade-off between where I will converge to and how much I explore and so on and so forth. But roughly the idea is you need to explore a lot at the beginning, right, so that you converge closer to the good solution faster, and then slowly turn off your exploration so that you get to optimal solutions. Okay. There are a whole bunch of other approaches. I mean, there's a whole family of literature based out of what are called learning automata. They go back to the 1930s, right? Originally started by a Russian mathematician, Setlin. And then there's this whole literature on looking at finite state machines and adapting them to solve this bandit problem, right? And then other approaches like median elimination, which is one of the landmark algorithms for achieving pack optimality, right? So, and then you have the upper confidence bound and Thompson sampling based methods, which give you regret optimality. So I'll just talk very briefly about upper confidence bound, because very popular algorithm that's not only used in for the immediate reinforcement problem, but increasingly being used in the delayed reinforcement setup as well, right? So you remember we are maintaining the expectation of the reward, right? We're maintaining an estimate of the expectation of the reward. That's what the cues were, right? But depending on the samples we have drawn, we can not only maintain an expectation, but we can also maintain some kind of an error bar, right? Some kind of a confidence interval around the current estimate of the expectation, right? So what the upper confidence bound algorithm says is very simple. Don't play the arm with the highest expectation. Play the arm with the highest upper bound on the expectation, right? So in this case, I'll play the red arm, even though that in some sense here has the least expected value. It has got the highest uncertainty about what the true value is. So I'll actually choose to play the red arm over the other two arms. So that's the basic idea. So now the trick is, how do I estimate this confidence bounds? Right? There are many, many, many techniques for estimating the confidence bounds. The simplest one is due to Peter Euer and others. And so which essentially says, use the Chernoff bound for coming up with an upper confidence interval. Right? And that's a very, very simple thing. So N is the number of times I have sampled different arms. And Nj is the number of times I have sampled arm j, right? And so the upper confidence bound is given by that expression, right? So this is actually very, very cheap to implement, right? And it's very fast, and it works very well in practice, right? So this is called the UCB1 algorithm, and all the improvements that have been proposed on top of UCB1 are essentially working on improving constants. So, but this is more or less the kind of hard bound on the performance. But there are a whole bunch of other constants which I am not talking about here. All the improvements are essentially on trying to make the constants smaller and smaller.
Usually,
we assume there are no temporal constants. we look at some other mechanisms for handling that. Yeah. So I mean, there's a whole literature on adversarial bandits, but we assume that there is an omniscient adversary who can actually keep changing the payoff functions depending on your state, the state of the learner, right? So yeah, that is a whole body of analysis based on that. Yeah. Right. And so far I've been talking about bandits that are just taking decisions, right? They're one, the bandit comes into existence, it makes a decision, then figures out what the right decision to do, and then goes away, right? But in reality, if you think about, as I was telling you about ad recommendation or news story recommendations and so on and so forth, you really don't want to show the same ad to every user who comes to your page, right? So you find when a different user comes to your page, you really want to have different ads showing up. So in some sense, you want the bandit algorithm to be aware of context, right? So relating it to what you heard earlier, so you want to take into account the stimulus that you're receiving before you decide on what the response is. Even if there is no notion of temporal sequencing involved, right? You at least want to pay attention to the immediate stimulus you're getting before you make a response, right? So these are called contextual bandits, right? And so the basic idea here is that we assume that the parameters of the reward distributions, right, are themselves determined by a set of hyperparameters. So the most common assumption we make in the contextual bandit setting is that there's a linear parameterization of the expectation of the reward distribution. So you remember I said there is a mu I, right? So mu I is given as some kind of summation, some xi into wi's, right? So where wi's are the hyperparameters and xi's are some features that encode the context, right? So in this case, like I was talking about features, you can assume that each feature is represent, each user is represented by a set of features. Right, and now the statistic that you use for choosing an arm, earlier it was just the Q of A, right, or the upper bound, right? The statistic for choosing the arm is now dependent on these features. Right? It's going to be a function of what kind of features you choose for encoding the users, right? And so these features could correspond to the presence or absence of different stimuli, as we saw earlier. I mean, that could be one feature that corresponds to whether a light comes on. That could be another feature that corresponds to whether a bell rings, and so on and so forth. Right? So you could actually think of having some kind of a parameterization like that, right? And now the expected payoff is going to be dependent on what set of stimuli are present, right? So that's one way of thinking about what relating this to what we saw earlier, right? And one of the very popular algorithms is actually dated, as you can see. There have been lots of work that has happened since then, but still from a deployment point of view, LinUCB is pretty robust, right? And so it's still pretty popular, where, like I said, you use a linear parameterization, right? And you use some ridge regression to fit the parameters and things. So there are some choices that they have made, so let's not go into the details, but eventually you use an UCB-like action selection. So you use ridge regression, but then you can also derive confidence bounds on the regression parameters that you fit. So use those confidence bounds to derive the upper confidence bounds on the rewards, and then use that for selecting actions. Okay. And you can see that when I have very little training data, so this is essentially like 1% of the users who come to my page give me feedback, right? Others don't, right? So even then I'm able to make very good predictions on whether somebody is going to click on an ad or not. And then, of course, if I have a lot of data, every algorithm starts doing well, right? But when I have very less data, so you can see that every other bar goes up, and every other bar is the UCB, LinUCB variant, right? So those actually perform well when you have lesser feedback. So this basically about the contextual bandits, right? So there are a lot of work that's going on. So there are a lot of powerful approximation techniques and sampling methods that are used. And the current champion in terms of this upper confidence bound methods is OFL, right? Which stands for optimism in the face of uncertainty. Okay. And of course, and Thompson sampling for linear contextual bandits, again, are giving you fantastic regret bounds. So kind of both are the current champs in terms of the performance measures. And you can also talk about complex dependencies, like I was saying, adversarial bandits, where you could talk about temporal dependencies. And there's something called multi-slot bandits, which is especially popular in ad selection cases. Right? It doesn't make sense. If you have three slots for showing ads, right? A, it doesn't make sense to show the same ad in all the three slots. And B, which ad you show along with others, actually can affect your click-through rates significantly. So they are not independent anymore. The payoffs are not independent anymore. So it introduces a whole slew of complications. So people have to look at that. And of course, budget-restricted things. And another line of work that's pretty interesting is the extension of many of these bandit ideas to the full reinforcement learning problem, right? And a lot of work has been done in the optimal exploration / exploration bonus space, where ideas are derived completely from the bandit literature. So like I said, the upper confidence bound ideas are now used pretty widely in solving full reinforcement learning problems as well. And a whole bunch of other migration has happened from the bandit community to the RL problems, right? So if people are interested, I mean, of course, these slides will be available. So these are some really good tutorials that summarize the historic work and up till that point, the state of the art in bandits, right? Okay, so now I'm going to move on. I'm going to talk about the full RL framework. Apologies for the lack of contrast. So that's an agent and that's an environment, right? So that could be a monkey pressing levers, right? Or it could be a rat running maze, or it could be a human riding a cycle, right? So there's some agent that's interacting with the environment. So the agent is sensing the state of the environment, getting all the kinds of sensory inputs, right? And takes an action in response to the sensory input. And there's some kind of a payoff that the agent is getting, some kind of an evaluation the agent is getting from the world, right? And so the distinguishing features here are, well, it learns from close interaction, right? But it's with a stochastic environment, so things could be a little uncertain, right? And it has noisy, delayed scalar evaluation. So the delayed part is what makes it different substantially from the bandit literature, right? And the goal of the agent here is to maximize a measure of long-term performance. Right? So performance as measured by this evaluation it is getting from the environment. Okay. So let's try to make this a slightly more formal. The same picture, right? But slightly with more labels here. So the agent senses a state at time t. So we call it st, right? And it takes an action, let's call it AT, right? And the action is applied to the environment, and as a result of which the environment transitions to a state ST plus 1, right? And also produces an evaluation, which we'll call RT plus 1 in this case, right? Just to keep the semantics consistent with the very popular textbook by Sutton and Barto, right? So if you go to some papers, they actually label this as RT versus RT plus 1, but these are minor things. Right? So this is basically the thing. So the agent will be at some state ST, right? It takes action AT, right? And it produces a reward RT plus 1 and causes a transition to state ST plus 1, and this interaction keep going. Right? And which one? The state. Good point. So the agent observes the state of the environment at state ST, right? So the environment is in state ST, the agent is not at state ST. Not in this formulation, right? So the way we kind of cheat in this formulation is if that is an agent state, like a battery state or something like that, we just make the battery part of the environment. So it becomes, so we can still keep talking about the environment state. So yeah, in this basic formulation, I ignore the agent state. Yeah, so there is no memory. The system is, you know, the agent is memoryless. The environment has memory, but the agent just observes everything. Right? It's kind of too simplistic an assumption, right? So the reason we were kind of doing this was it made it computationally easier to handle. But now with all the powerful sequence learners that people are putting out, absolutely. I completely agree with you on that, but the point was people were trying to connect this to the OR literature where they had actually talked about similar problem solving, and there it made sense to just say that, okay, the environment has the memory, the agent doesn't, right? And then you're just going to transfer all the stochastic dynamic programming solutions from OR to here and then start relating it to the TD learning rule and so on and so forth, right? So there, so kind of historically people started ignoring the state. So Andy Barto always keeps saying that reinforcement learning people made the big mistake of mistaking the MDP for the world. So that's something which then now I guess as a community we're getting out of. And well, deep learning helped, right? All the powerful sequence learners that you have in deep learning, right? So allows us to actually think of states which are sequences. And so have the agent can also have internal memory now. So that's kind of people are moving away from this basic model, but this is where we have to start anyway. Okay. So the goal of the agent is to learn a policy, which we'll call PyT. And so you could also think of it as a mapping from states to actions, right? So given a current state, I'll tell you what action to take, or I can think of it as action distributions, right? So why would I think of it as a distribution over action? Because I want to do exploration, right? So I don't want to just take the one action all the time. I might want to do some exploration. So I can think of this as a stochastic policy, right? And basically what reinforcement learning methods do is specify how the agent changes its policy as a result of the experience it's getting from the world, right? It makes all these transitions, it's seeing rewards, it's seeing next states, right? As a result of this experience, how does the agent change its policy, right? So that's what all RL methods do. And roughly the agent's goal is to get as much reward as it can, right? I mean, there are other kinds of criteria that you can put in, but that's basically the goal, right? Just to connect you back to what you saw earlier, right? So this is basically the goal of the agent. Is to learn to take a sequence of actions so that it gets the as much reward as possible in the long run, right? And so the tricky part here is that even though I have to learn action at only at S1, let us say, but it still depends on the actions that I have to take further down the line, right? And there is no immediate feedback, right? So what is it that we are supposed to maximize, right? So we are going to maximize what we call a return, right? What or the expectation of the return, right? And depending on the nature of the problem, we can define return in multiple ways, right? So the one definition that you saw in the earlier talk was just that it's the sum of the rewards that you're going to get till you hit a terminal state, right? So until the mouse ends up with the cheese or the water or nothing, right? You just sum up all the rewards and that gives you a return, right? So for every trajectory that you generate through the space, you get a return, right? You can compute a return. But what happens if there is interaction does not have natural episodes like this, right? So suppose riding a cycle, right? If it really doesn't have a natural episode, you just want to stay balanced on the cycle, right? It's not like, okay, I want to stay balanced for 4 time steps and then I'm done, right? So ideally you want to learn a policy that can allow you to balance indefinitely, not infinitely, indefinitely, right? So you don't want to have a 3 step or 4 step horizon, right? So in such cases, what we do is we go for something called a discounted return, where the future rewards, right, are exponentially decayed, so that this whole sum will stay bounded, even if I am actually going to sum over an infinite number of terms, right? So that's a mathematical justification for doing it. Another justification is to say that, hey, if gamma goes to zero, that means I'm only worried about my immediate reward. I'm not worried about what will happen as a future consequence of my action, right? It's like a 3-year-old playing chess, right? I mean, okay, there, I can take the piece now, great. I don't care if I lose in the 3 steps down. In fact, you should try explaining it to a 3-year-old. I mean, they won't even have the concept of long-term consequence of their actions, right? So, and when gamma gets closer to 1, then you become far-sighted, right? You're not only worried about the immediate consequence, you're actually looking at what would happen down the line as well. So you could think of more of a psychological explanation for that. And of course, what we are interested in is maximizing the expectation of this return, right? And as we saw earlier, we call this the value function, right? So a value function associated with the state S, when you are following policy pi, right, is the expected value of the return, right, starting from the state S, and I'm conditioning it on pi as well, assuming that every action is taken according to the policy pi. So this is essentially what so Peter defined as the value in the previous talk as well. Okay. On board so far? Great. I'm going to introduce another notion of a value function, which we call the action value function. You'll see why I need it a little later. So here I'm talking about the value of taking an action in a state S, right? Not just the value of a state S. I'm talking about value of taking an action in a state S. So the value of taking an action in state S under policy pi is essentially the return you accumulate, assuming you start in state S and you take action A. So that's the difference between this. Here you just start in state S. Here I've assumed that I have taken action A as my first action. And then what is the future? Right? So I take the expected reward, assuming I start off by taking action A. Okay? So this is called the action value function. So if you notice, I've gone back to using the Q notation, because typically we use the Q notation when we want to associate a value with the action. And we use the V notation when you want to associate a value with the state. So this is one, that's a common notational thing, right? So recall the basic idea of the Bellman equation. So I have my GT can be written like this, and then I can rewrite it so that GT is recursively written as RT plus 1 plus gamma GT plus 1, right? And so I can write my Bellman equation like that. There you go, that's Bellman, right? So that's essentially writing this recursively. So the tricky part here is, how do you evaluate the expectation, right? So I need to know something about the system for me to evaluate the expectation. So one of the things that, you know, it did help the field advance a lot, but in some sense it also held it back a little bit, is we make the assumption known as the Markov assumption, right? So we assume that, suppose I have this history of state actions, rewards that have happened from the beginning of time, right? So the probability that the next state is S prime and the next reward I'm going to get is R, right, is going to depend only on the immediate preceding state and the immediate preceding action. Right? So everything else before that is irrelevant. Right? So what I'm essentially saying is that the state is not a sensory state, but it is a complete summary of everything that I need in order to be able to make a prediction about the future. So that's, in some sense, a strong assumption. So people kind of get around that by trying to make the state description more and more complex, more and more complicated, so that it becomes harder to implement as a system. But you can still get around the Markov assumption, right? But it would be better if you can come up with methods that don't need it at all in the first place, right? instead of trying to come up with techniques that get around that. Right. So this is fine, right? So this Markov property is something which engineers, especially electrical engineers, know a lot about. But we use that here in reinforcement learning as well, right? And so if a reinforcement learning task has the Markov property, it essentially becomes what is called a Markov addition process, which is described by these tuple, right? S, A, P, and R. Sometimes people add a discount factor also to this gamma. Right. So S is the set of states that the environment can be in. A is the set of actions that the agent can take. And I have one step dynamics, because I don't have to worry about too much. I don't have to worry about the past, right? So I'm just going to say P S A S prime. It's a probability that I'll end up in S prime, given that I started in S and took action A in one step, right? This and then I also have the reward expectation. So where R S A is especially the expected reward I'll get at time t plus 1. Assuming I was at state S and I took action A. Okay, so this is basically all I need to describe my reinforcement learning problem, assuming that this one step, this Markov assumption is true. Right? So sometimes it's a powerful assumption, but it helps us overcome something. Here's a very simple example, right? And I need to show this, because historically reinforcement learning, at least the computational side of things, right, has stayed too long on grid worlds. So I can't give a reinforcement learning intro talk without showing at least one grid world. Right, so here is, so this is what's called a grid world. And so each cell here that you see is actually a state that the environment is in, right? So the agent can occupy one of these states. So the state of the environment is the cell that the agent occupies right now. And the actions are four actions, north, south, east, and west. And the agent could possibly get a penalty of minus 1 for every time step it moves. And the goal is to reach the cell marked G, at which point the episode terminates, right? So the sooner you reach G, the lesser the number of minus 1s you get. So for it to behave optimally would be to take the shortest path to reach the goal. Okay, so that's essentially the idea here. So it's a very simple MDP. And now that we have the components in place, we can go back and revisit the Bellman equation. Right, now I can rewrite the Bellman equation without the expectation operator as so pi sa, which is the probability of picking action A in state S. Once I pick the action A in state S, then this is the expectation of the reward. Right, so the EPI of RT plus 1 is RSA, which is what we defined earlier. And this PSA prime is the probability of going to state S prime. And V pi S prime is what I'm putting in here, right? Expectation over V of ST plus 1. So now, as you can see, what can you see immediately about this set of equations? It's a set of equations, right? One for each value of each state, right? So v pi of s1 is a variable, v pi of s2 is a variable, and so on and so forth. And what else can you see? It's a linear system of equations, right? And you can actually solve this system of equations because of the fact that P is a stochastic matrix, right? So there is a solution that exists. There's a unique solution that exists for this system of linear equations, and you can just solve it. And you can find the value for v pi. Okay. So I'm kind of moving you away from all this iterative update rules, and I'm just telling you that you can solve the reinforcement learning or at least the evaluation problem by just solving a system of linear equations, right? So I'm going to talk about evaluation versus control. So far what we have looked at is evaluating a given policy. So given pi, find v pi. That's basically what I call the evaluation, right? So this is the, I told you one way of finding v pi, which was essentially solve a system of linear equations. And what we saw in the previous talk was that you could use this algorithm called temporal difference learning, which also solves for v pi, right? And in an iterative fashion, right? And what is the nice thing about temporal difference learning here? There is no P, there is no R. Right, I'm assuming that you don't have any notion of the system, any idea of the system parameters itself, and that you are just drawing samples from the world, right? So, you know, all I need to know is my ST and my ST plus 1, and what is the RT I got from the world, right? So, essentially, I can just draw samples from the world, right, and then I can estimate the value function. So, that's what the nice thing about the TD method is, because it uses this bootstrapping, right? And okay, I'll skip that. It uses bootstrapping and is able to learn without any idea of the parameters of the MDP, right? And so what I'm really interested in is learning an optimal policy. So Peter Dayan talked about one way of learning the optimal policy. What was that? Well, it was towards the end. And so believe me, Peter was actually talking much slower than he normally does. But still it was hard to follow him towards the end because he was speeding up in interest of time. So essentially what he was saying was you start off with a guess for a policy, right? Then you use your TD learning, you evaluate the policy, right? Figure out what V pi should be, right? Now what you do, you go and change your policy such that you now go to states which have a higher value than what you had earlier. So you start off with some guess for a policy. Right, the initial policy started off with a uniformly random policy, right? So at any point, you'll just take left or right with probability 0.5, right? And then he found out what is the value for that policy, right? Then he had this 1, 2, and 3, and so on and so forth, right? He evaluated that policy, and then what he said is, okay, I'll now go to states, so I'll change my policy so that I go to states which have a higher value than where I am currently, right? And I keep iterating this until I converge to a policy which doesn't change, right? So this is called form of policy iteration. The way he presented it is what's called generalized policy iteration. Right? That's one way of solving for the optimal policy. Right? I'm going to talk about another way of solving for, a couple of different ways of solving for the optimal policy. So here basically you're learning to control the system. So that's why we call it the control problem. And the goal here is to find a policy that has the highest expected return among all policies that you can consider. And typically, we operate in a restricted class of policies. I mean, if I say universally all policies, then the search space becomes very large. So I try to restrict the class of policies. And so we can learn such a policy directly. That's what the direct actor part was about. But I'm going to talk more about learning this policy through an optimal value function. So I'm just going to give you some intuition as to how we are going to go about doing this instead of doing a very rigorous mathematical thing, right? So let's start off with this first case that we had. I'm going to build up to the full RL problem. So we had a bandit problem where there were three decisions you had to take, right? And then solving it meant finding the action which had the highest expected reward, right? Then we talked about the contextual bandit case where there is some state J, right? And then solving it for the state J meant picking the action that had the highest expected value in the state J, right? Now let's look at the full reinforcement learning problem. So I have some action some state I, right? I take an action and then I end up in J, and then from J I have a contextual bandit problem, right? If you think about it, right? So what did Peter say in that slide? So you're going to use the prediction that you're going to have about the future as a surrogate instead of your reward, right? So essentially we'll do that, right? So we'll just worry about whatever is in the dotted box is a bandit problem, right? I'm going to solve the bandit problem, and I'm going to assume the solution that I get for the bandit problem will be passed on to the previous state as the reward, right? I could just keep doing this, right? So essentially I can think of, I have a solution for the bandit problem, I'm going to pass it on to this, now I have a solution for this problem, and I'm going to pass it on back to I1, right, like that. So I can essentially, one way of thinking about it, I start from the last step and I solve the problem back, right? And of course, that's a very nice linear thing, but that's not how it's going to operate. I'm going to have multiple possible outcomes when I take action from I, right? So I have to do some kind of an expectation over all the outcomes, right? So that's putting all of those together, right? So I'm doing an expectation over all outcomes, right, of RT plus 1, which is the reward I'm going to get for the first step. Then what's the best I could do? This is essentially the solution of things that come further down the line. Right? So putting all this together, I actually now get something that looks like a Bellman equation, right? But this is a Bellman optimality equation because I put this max in here. Right? And it's kind of, you can show that this is actually, I'll come to that in a little bit, right? And so Q star is the optimal value function, right? That's a unique solution for this system of nonlinear equations, right? Kind of get the intuition, right? I'm not doing it very rigorously. Kind of, I guess, last talk of the day, so pictures might help, right? So why am I finding Q star? Because once I have Q star, remember, Q star is the expected value of starting in a state and doing action A and behaving optimally thereafter. Okay, that is what the max was getting me, and I'm behaving optimally thereafter. So I can recover the optimal policy by just saying, okay, in state S, pick the action that has the highest Q star value, right? Because after that, I'm assuming I'm behaving optimally, right? So every state I pick the action that has the highest Q star value, and that gives me the optimal policy, right? So recall the Bellman optimality equation, right? So that's the optimality equation. I can convert that into a backup equation like this. So I make a guess for the Q values, right? I plug it to the right hand side of this equation, do this computation, right? And then I get a new guess for the Q values. So I can just keep iterating this, right, until I converge to the Q star, right? And we can actually show that this is a contraction operator, and the optimal function is a unique fixed point of this contraction, right? And in some sense, it's a form of dynamic programming. So people, computer science people in the audience would understand what dynamic programming does. So the basic idea here is that you solve smaller instances of a problem. Right? And in some sense, use those solutions to solve larger instances of a problem. Very roughly, what dynamic programming would do. And in this case, what were you doing? You're essentially solving a k-step reinforcement learning problem. Right? And using that to solve a k plus one step reinforcement learning. This is in some sense going back one step, one state. Right? So you use to solve a k-step reinforcement learning problem. And then use that to solve a k plus one step reinforcement learning problem. So in some sense, it's a dynamic programming approach. Right? So that's one way of solving for the control problem. Because once I get Q star, I have my pi star, right? So here's another way of doing it, which is the equivalent of the TD learning way of doing the solution. I want to do a fully incremental learning algorithm. So one of the most popular control algorithms is known as Q learning, right? It doesn't need knowledge of the system dynamics. All it needs are these kinds of trajectories that you generate through the state space. And what you do now is, essentially, if you look at this, right? So that's essentially the error term, right? So this is what my current estimate gives me, right? So, right, and that's my current case, and this is what I'm shooting for, right? So this is what I'm shooting for. This is what my right-hand side is, right? This is what I'm shooting for, right? And that's what my current estimate is, right? So in some sense, I have this TD error. In a different form, right? Earlier you didn't have the max, right? Now since I'm trying to learn for control, I have a TD error version which has a max in there, right? And I use the TD error and I keep updating the parameters and eventually converge to Q star. I'm hiding a few technical conditions under the rug here, but you have to make sure that you explore enough, that you need to have some kind of epsilon ready kind of exploration strategy at least, and your alphas have to cool down. You can't keep a constant alpha. So under both these conditions, then this will converge to Q star. Now we have another way of solving the control problem, right? So this is both these methods fall under TD learning and Q learning fall under a large class of algorithms called temporal difference learning, and there are other classes of algorithms, basically what we call policy search algorithms, where we don't necessarily maintain a value function, we directly search in the space of control policies, right? And one thing that's gaining a lot of popularity is on evolutionary algorithms, which, like Peter, I also put on the slide and I'm not going to talk about. And of course, the last class of algorithms is stochastic dynamic programming, and which has a strong history, tradition from the OR community in solving MDPs. So a couple of things that I want to mention beyond this basic setup. The first thing is the need for generalization, or rather, probably the only thing I'm going to get to is the need for generalization. So there are many reasons why we'd want to generalize. The most naive of this is that if you want to go to a very large state space, right, it's going to be hard for you to just store everything as a explicitly specified cell, you know, like the grid wall like thing, right? So it's very hard for you to do that. But the second thing is there is significant data sparsity. You're not going to experience every possible outcome in the world. You need to have some kind of a parameterized representation of the values or the policies, or even if you're learning the model, you need to have a parameterized representation of the model, right? There are so many factors that can influence outcome, and then in fact, if you're talking about control systems, people do have very good intuition and very good physics would give you models of the world, right? It'll be a shame if you're going to ignore all this parameterization that people have already built up and then going to say, I'm moving into a tabular representation of what reinforcement, that's the best thing that reinforcement learning can do. So the idea here is to use some kind of parameterized representation. So here is an example, right? So historically, RL folks used linear parameterization. So I have this W's are my the parameters, and phi of S is some kind of encoding of the state. So it could be going back to all the way to the beginning. It could be whether the light is present or the tone is present, and so on and so forth. What kind of stimuli are there? Or it could be what angle my cycle is leaning, right? So 30 degrees to the vertical, or what's the angular velocity with which I'm falling, and things like this. So there could be a variety of factors that describe what the world is, right? And so that's my value function, right? And what I'm really shooting for is my v hat should become v pi, right? So that's the actual error function that I'm shooting for, right? So v pi minus v hat, right? That's essentially the error. So I'm basically looking at some kind of a squared error fit here. But the tricky part is I don't really know what my v pi is. If I know my v pi, I have no learning problem left, right? So how do I fake my v pi? Right, so I basically use the TD target, right? So instead of V pi, I'm going to say, I'm just going to use this as my estimate for what V pi should be, right? So this is essentially the idea behind TD, right? So I'm saying that RT plus 1 plus V of ST plus 1 is a better estimate of the target value than my current estimate, which is V hat ST, right? So I'm just going to take that as my error, and then this reduces just my delta function that we had earlier, right? And now I can come up with a algorithm which is like linear TD, which is the parameterized version of the TD algorithm that Peter Dayan presented, right? And so it's got some nice convergence properties, but for complex parameterizations, we really don't have that much results. In fact, we have zero results in terms of convergence and so on and so forth. But we have some many successful examples. In fact, that the world's best TD Gammon player I was telling you about, right, used a pretty complex neural network at the heart of it, right? And then this is something that kind of kick-started or reignited interest in reinforcement learning a couple of years ago. This company which was DeepMind, became Google DeepMind, became DeepMind again, did a few years back, where they trained a reinforcement learning agent to play Atari games from scratch, okay? And so if you look at the setup here, right? Where did this phi of S come from? Some designer thought about it and wrote down what the phi vector should be, right? And the Atari games case, what they did was they basically gave all the raw pixel information to the RL agent, and it just formed the representation that it needed, right? and then it had a final layer of neural network on top of this representation learning that learned to play Atari games. And all it used was that queue learning update rule I showed you, nothing more complex. Right? Of course, now the field has moved far, far ahead from what the deep queue network that they used for this game. Right? And I don't have time, I'm going to skip this video, but it's, you have hazard versions of this video online. Right? Go there and search for Google DeepMind Atari game videos. You'll get enough videos on different blogs. Right? And of course, this is what I was talking, and Joshua was saying that this is the best player of Go in the world right now. Right? And this is not, but the thing is, it doesn't just use reinforcement learning. Right? It actually used a very detailed search strategy as well, combined with deep reinforcement learning in order to come up with an amazing player of Go. So what is the interesting part is Go has been for a long time considered one of the final frontiers of game playing AI because its branching factor is so large, right? It's very hard to come up with an even halfway decent Go playing agent. I mean, so one of the few games for which you would not find a good agent online. But these guys are playing so well. Look at the expression on Lee Sedol's face.
One of the things
Yeah, I completely agree. Same thing happened with the backgammon case also. Backgammon also, the networks trained by playing against each other. Dealing with the word is a very hard problem. I completely agree. See, the thing about this though is that the agent was not told the rules of Go.
No.
So, in some sense, from the agent, in the sense that the rules did exist,
yes.
That's the point. And in real world, rules might not even exist. That's the point.
Yeah.
Go does have simple rules, yeah. But the point is, the agent was not told the rules of Go. For example, in the helicopter. In the helicopter case also, right? In the learning to fly the helicopter. So it was not told the physics or anything. It's basically learning things from scratch.
Sure.
They obey the rules. Yeah. Yeah. So, I mean, they in some sense have to obey the rules because non-kosher moves were actually ignored. Right? So they had to actually repick the moves. Technically, what they were not aware of is actually the goal of the game. When they were not told, I mean, the agent was not told initially, what is it that you need to do to win the game? And only when it, by accident, stumbled upon the winning positions, was it given a reward. That actually made it complicated.
Ravi,
yeah.
What are the features of well-posed problems or games that reinforced learning could excel in? What are the features that it would fail at?
So, they reinforcement learning, I mean, both of these cases, right? I mean, there is no hidden state, right? In some sense, what you see on
the
board is what you get. Not only the rules are explicit, it's like playing cards, right? I mean, playing cards, I mean, they have hidden state, right? You don't know what the agents. So, handling hidden state is still a problem for, even with all this computational explosion that deep learning gives you, right? Handling hidden state is still a problem. So, games where bridge, for example, would be hard still for reinforcement learning agents to crack, right? So having said that, I mean, maybe given infinite amount of exploration, it can learn to card count and things like that. I mean, I'm not excluding that possibility, but still it would be hard for it to learn. Right, so that is one thing for sure. And the other
even
would be if
the
there is...
Rules can be laid down for bridge, right?
Even though the rules can be laid down for bridge, very, very, very
yes.
Detailed rules. Yeah, I agree, yeah. And things where, of course, the rules change over time, I mean, hopeless. So, I mean, you have to have very special techniques for handling non-stationarity and that too, only special kinds of non-stationarity. So, that's hard.
Somebody should work on this. Somebody should lay out what is solvable now, what is not, and why. And I think that would lead to major problems.
Sure. I agree.
Yeah, I know, but those are like NP problem, NP hard and so forth.
Yeah, not
that's not what I'm
no,
talking
no,
about.
Even from,
I'm talking
for,
about algorithmically
no, for,
solvable, but yet in the blind world of deep learning, sorry, would be hard. I'm just saying.
Joshua left, yeah, so you can tell that it's good. I don't think Mrigankar is talking about
that.
That
is a way to get some analytical understanding of why do algorithms work.
Yeah.
You know, otherwise I've been listening, and it is. I think reinforcement learning has the most structure of the various, you know, subfield, if you will, of the most analytical structure, in my personal opinion.
Okay.
And I'm not an expert, and yet I'm going to stop.
Point there, which is to define, you know, there is kind of experimental exploration going on right now where people devise algorithms and they test them against real world data sets. The more traditional method was you define your problem in a mathematical sense, you write down what is the problem that is being solved, rather than say I succeeded because I translated speech, right? So that's kind of been a change that has taken place. So
Yeah, and I've got to encourage that change. Exactly right.
And then to really understand the algorithms, one does have to define the problems. These computer games have the advantage that they are well defined, but perhaps they're not real world enough. So maybe one needs good mathematical models of the real world, you know, coming back to.
So, the RL community is pretty much aware of that.
Workspace is also very crucial.
So, for example, another very popular domain that, in fact, we have actually done some work on it, which is it's called Mojoco, okay? But it's a very realistic physics simulator of different kinds of gates, right? So you have like a bipedal gate and then a hopping gate, and then you have like a biped, but more like a cheetah kind of thing, like a quadruped sliced in slight lengthwise, but so you can actually learn gates for those kinds of things. So there are like 16 to 18 different actual physics domains where you have to learn different kinds of gates for different systems, right? And then people have succeeded. In fact, there is an algorithm called trust region policy optimization, which achieves almost optimal performance on these kinds of domains. And so like that, there are many such more, I don't know, not really ill-defined, but much harder dynamics than simple games. And people are moving.
Even for simple supervised learning, let's say, which is a good base of analysis.
Sure.
One has a good probability distribution that produces real-world like images.
Mm-hmm.
You go up
to the
number. Sure.
There's a number. Sure. Yeah.
Then that number can compare.
Sure. We could do that. I mean, but
that's a kind of a cultural change.
No, people are. I mean, in the classification community, there's a whole different notion of complexity classes, right? I mean, the people do talk about that, and there has been work that a large empirical community actually compares to Bayes optimality for simpler problems for which you can compute for which the data distribution is known a priori, right? But I personally feel that reinforcement learning should not be used to solve problems of classification, because you already have very powerful tools for doing that. You should just co-opt it. Not try to solve this from reinforcement learning.
Very powerful statistical tools for, you know.
So that's one of the things I was pointing out for that RoboSoccer domain, right? Basically, they used reinforcement learning to solve a very, very specific task, which was not amenable for other conventional solution approaches. So I think whatever lifelong learning agent that people come up with, it can't just focus on RL or unsupervised learning. It has to be like a mix of all kinds of things, including some amount of logic and planning and everything.
Some pre-wired architectures.
Sorry?
Some pre-wired architectures. Since I see that understanding biological underpinning is one of the
chief challenges
you have put forward for the field.
Yeah.
I agree with that.
Yeah, I completely agree. So, and this is the other thing, it's learning more detailed structure, right? So right now, most of the sensory representation that we use are like a flat vector representation, which is certainly not the right way to think about the world. And the deep learning tools give us something, right? right? But we don't know what exactly. We are not exactly sure what is the structure that they are learning, and we're still trying to tease apart the structure learned of the sensory information. And also there is a whole other level of structure that you can learn on the policy side of things, right? Instead of thinking about just taking actions, and you can actually think about taking a tree. I mean, there's a tree of action that you have to traverse. It's not like a set that you pick from, right? So there's whole structure that you can think about that as well, right? And we still have to work on that. So that the policy structuring has very little work has been done, especially since the revival of DeepRL. Right. So after that, people have just lost focus in the last 3-4 years. Now they're getting back. But the sensory representation, we have black box sensors. So we need to understand what the black box is doing. Right. And of course, I mean, Joshua's group has been making tremendous advantage. In fact, they're working very closely with the reinforcement learning team at McGill. And so they've been producing some very good DeepRL analysis, more than the high profile Go player public display things which DeepMind produces. These guys have been producing more meaningful analysis of what comes out. Right? And the last thing which I have, so we still need practical application. We still need things that go out there and are deployed, like many classification. Like, so there are so many things that SVMs. I want a reinforcement learning washing machine out there, right? So like people talk about fuzzy washing machine and neuro vacuum cleaners and things like that, right? So we want something that goes out there and works on the real, huh? Yeah. We want something that works on real problems and robust. But it's needed. Okay, and if people want to look at more references and stuff like that, a lot of material there, right? And so the Sutman Bhatto book, second edition is out, which is a significantly revamped, well, not out, it's on Rich's webpage. So it's a significantly revamped version. So it talks about many of the recent developments in reinforcement learning. So it's a good place to start. Okay, so any questions? Or
my question is more along the adaptivity in changing environment situations where the agent operating in the environment, and the environment is not stable as such, and it is constantly evolving in its nature. Yeah. So how do we solve?
So the answer, well, as with many questions, is depends. It depends on the time scale at which the environment is changing, right? So if the agent can actually, if the agent's learning algorithms, rate of convergence is like an order of magnitude faster than the rate of change, right? You could make sure that you kind of don't decay parameters to zero, right? And still manage to track the change in the environment. But if the environment is changing very rapidly, then your only hope is that there is some kind of periodicity in the changing in the change, in which case you can try to learn at that period, right? And then you can try to solve the problem. But if it's going to be absolutely chaotic and at a much, much more rapid time scale than what the agent can track.
And second part of my question is, what if there are infinite states that can be transitioned?
Sure, I had it on one of the slides. So in the generalization case, right, when I start talking about parameterized functions, then I could just do infinite states. There's no problem. In fact, in the Mojoko domain, I'm actually doing things like angles of joints and torques and stuff like that, which are essentially continuous values between 0 to 2 pi. So I can represent those as well.
Here we'll thank Dr. Ravindran for a nice overview and talk.